We're back, and we have with us a former consumer, or I should say fellow consumer advocate, Jean Meyer. Jean, how are you?
I'm fine, Chuck. How are you?
Good. Now, let me ask you the first question, if I may. You live down in what we call hurricane damage country.
Sir.
You still got any blue roofs around?
Oh, we've got plenty of them.
Tell everybody what that means.
That means their roof was probably damaged by a hurricane, and maybe their insurance hasn't settled with them or something, and they can't afford to get another roof on their house yet. Or it may be that there's just too many roofing companies that are so busy that they just don't have time to do them.
So why is the roof blue?
Well, hurricane damage, usually they put a tarp on it, and we call them blue roofs.
All right, blue tarp.
Yep.
Yep.
As a matter of fact, I've had to put my hurricane-damaged house up for sale.
Oh?
Yep. Apparently, code enforcement said my house was too badly damaged, and either I had to spend the $30,000 to bring it up to their standards, or you rebuild another house. So I'm selling my house at a loss to get out from underneath it and get out from under code enforcement's issues.
Well, now, what would the new buyer do?
The new buyer will probably take the house down and put a brand new house up on this property.
I see. Is the lot that valuable?
Well, I have a very good size lot, a corner lot, you know. So I'll actually walk away with half the value of my house. You know, if it wasn't hurricane damaged, I would have had a whole lot more.
What will you then do?
Well, we've already bought another house out in Kansas. We're going to live more on less. I have a nice house out there. It was a whole lot less expensive. And, you know, I'll be able to have a little better life out there that where I'm not in Hurricane Alley.
What will you do to make a living in Kansas?
Oh, basically the same thing I do now. You know, book radio and television talk show guests. As long as I have a telephone and internet access, I have a job. I'll continue to sell my Tupperware, do my online things that I have now, but I'm actually thinking about opening an internet cafe.
In Kansas?
Yep.
Whereabouts?
It's a small town called Belleville. It's about 10 miles from the Nebraska border in Kansas, right about the very center of the state. There's about 2,000 people in the town.
Now, you realize, I'm trying to be your friend here, that you're going to spend an awful lot of money to heat that house in the wintertime.
Yep. Well, I figure it's roughly the same as it is, you know, to heat air down here in the wintertime. I mean, I pay $200 a month in electric here every single month anyway.
Well, I think you're going to find it's going to cost a whole lot more than that in the wintertime up north. What kind of heat do you have?
Well, we have the house that we have now has central heat and air.
No.
It's also got two fireplaces. And it's got floor heating, radiant floor heating.
The one in Kansas?
Yes. It's supposed to be an energy-efficient home.
Yeah, but what kind of radiant floor heating?
I don't know. I haven't looked at all of that.
Yeah. I'm afraid you're going to get a terrible shock when you try to heat it this winter. I hate to tell you that. I know a number of folks who live in what I call the snow belt. And one gentleman found out it's going to cost him $3,600 to heat his house this winter.
Wow, that's a lot of money.
Yeah. And if you got the radiant heat in the floor, it sounds to me like that might be, it's either electric or it's hot water. If it's hot water, it's probably oil fired. And you're talking about a lot of money for that oil heat. I think you need to do some checking because... you say it has two fireplaces?
Yes.
Well, you might want to look into the possibility of going into what they call a freestanding airtight stove. They're made out of steel, and you can pipe them into the fireplace, but they sit in front of the fireplace out in the room, and they put out a tremendous amount of heat with very, very little wood. And if there's a lot of trees and wood around there, then wood probably would be cheap and you could heat with wood.
Yep, that's kind of what we're thinking too. The good part is Kansas, the city that we live in, only gets 18 inches of snow a year. So, I mean, it's not like when I lived in Michigan where you had, you know, 6 feet on the ground all year round.
Yeah, but it's cold.
Yeah, it's cold. You know, but, you know, we'll see what happens. You know, I'm optimistic about it.
Were you able to buy the house for what you got left?
Yes.
I see.
Actually, let me tell you something. This is one of the great secrets that I had written into my column this month. As you know, a lot of people who live in the cities, you know, you're barely making your rent and your mortgage and things like that. There are lots of houses in Kansas. You can buy a four-bedroom house for $20,000.
Really?
I bought a four-bedroom, two-bath with a garage underneath it and a full basement on a 130 by 150 lot for $14,000.
And why is that?
Because it's a small town. I mean, there's not a whole lot of work there. So if you have something that you can do out of your home and you bring your own job, then it doesn't really matter where you live. It's a small farming town. A lot of people live on farms. You know, and so the real value of the property is, you know, basically what you could sell it for. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not the kind of property that, you know, there's going to be all kinds of new subdivisions and stuff going up. And a lot of these houses are very well built. You know, they're older houses. This house was built in 1910.
Is it brick or wood?
It's got a limestone foundation, and it's limestone, the bottom half, and the top is wood.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a very sturdy house. As a matter of fact, it has red cedar floors.
Wow. Wow. Well, I think that a lot of people are going to have to find someplace else to live because they're going to be priced out of Florida. You know, the theory is that Florida will develop to be 3 to 4 times the size of population that it is right now. You've heard that, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. And, I mean, it's already showing up here in Melbourne. We have house prices have just gone through the roof, especially in the last year alone. My children's school has doubled its occupancy in 1 year. You know, so that's really a lot of people are moving to Florida.
Mm-hmm.
I see it being another California in another couple of years.
Yeah, but the problem is it cannot continue on because we don't have the water.
Yep, and you know, along with growth comes crime and all kinds of other things too.
Yeah.
You know, and so that's part of the reason, you know, why. You know, my kids are a little bit older now, and so I've decided, you know, I need to live in an area that's just a little less influential.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of folks are taking a look at rural America, what I call out the road, like Kansas or the Midwest, you know, Nebraska, what have you.
Yeah.
There's a lot of little towns in Wisconsin and Michigan, especially in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, that are essentially ghost towns.
Yes, there are. And people could do a search on the Internet and find reasonable-priced houses, you know, in certain areas. I mean, there's an Amazon warehouse 1 hour's drive from where I live.
Hmm.
You think about it, you know, a lot of people drive an hour a day to work. So if you could live out in a rural area and have to earn less money and spend less money to live, then maybe it would benefit you, too.
All right. When we come back, you can tell us how to look for cheap real estate, and also we'll talk about products and what else you have on your mind. Chuck Carter for the People, right back.
Say, do you or a member of your family suffer from acne? Do you take prescription drugs and get little or no relief? Is your skin always dry and itching and peeling due to the side effects of chemicals and drugs? You have trouble looking in the mirror and being happy with what you see? Do you avoid going out in the world due to your acne? Are you spending ridiculous amounts of money with little or no results? Well, you may find relief. Relief is available to most sufferers online at healthstarproducts.com. It's guaranteed or you get your money back, and you've got 90 days to decide. Look it up for yourself online at Health Star Products, H-E-A-L-T-H, healthstarproducts.com. Go to www.healthstarproducts.com and find out about the acne program. Find out if it works for you or a member of your family. If it doesn't, you get your money back. I I've been reading online about a drug-free home treatment program that suggests you can be asthma-free. It's a program designed by an ex-asthmatic who claims she cured her own asthma. It's based on a little-known but astounding clinical trial at a major hospital. What would you give to be free of asthma, asthma symptoms, and sinus and allergy symptoms, to breathe easily, freely, naturally, in a relaxed way? This drug-free method, proven by clinical trials, is guaranteed or you get your money back, and you have 90 days to decide. Get to a computer now and go to HealthStarProducts.com. That's www.HealthStarProducts.com. Read about the asthma program, and if it doesn't do what it says it'll do for you, you get your money back, and you've got 90 days to decide. Go to HealthStarProducts.com.
We're back with Gene Meyer, and Gene, give out your website, if you would.
Oh, people can sign up for my free newsletter at livingmoreonless.com.
Do it again.
People can sign up for my free newsletter at livingmoreonless.com.
All right. How do you find cheap real estate?
Well, you know, you have to start by just thinking about where you might want to live, where are some of the lower populations in America, and start looking there. Go on the internet, type in Kansas real estate, Nebraska, Oklahoma, and you'll come up with several ones. And if you're looking to live in a rural area, type in, you know, rural Kansas real estate. I know I've looked at approximately 600 houses online before I bought the one that I bought. And I was very selective. I didn't go and look at the town before I bought the house. I mean, it's not a sight unseen or anything like that. I was very happy with the town. And let me tell you, there's been some very positive effects of this move. One thing is my 16-year-old daughter absolutely loves it in the country. And I thought the culture shock would kill them. She's been there for 3 months now. She absolutely loves it. She likes going out and riding horses. She likes riding dirt bikes with her friends. You know, all these things that we couldn't do sitting in town.
Well, now, is your family already out there in Kansas?
My husband and my daughter is. My son and my youngest son are here because my little guy had to finish summer school. So we'll be going out there in a couple more weeks. One of the other positive things is, you know, my son's elementary school that he goes to right now, he's in fourth grade. They had over 130 kids in the fourth grade in his school. In the school in Belleville, they have 12 fourth graders. So what a difference in attention from the teacher alone. You know, it's 12 students to one teacher as opposed to 35 to one. The high school has approximately 180 kids, where the high school my daughter was going to had 2,000 kids.
Yeah.
You know, major culture shock, and I thought, you know, my kids are going to be hopping up and down, yelling and screaming, we want to go back to Florida. But instead, they absolutely have loved it.
I'll bet there's no chain-link fence around the school with a sheriff's car there every day, huh?
No, and you know what's really weird, Chuck, is they handle things totally different. You know, things like here, let's say they catch your kids smoking at school here, you know, big no-no, and they're going to call the police and make this a major incident. And school up in Kansas, you know, they take away extracurricular activities and things like that. They don't want to ruin your child's education. You know, they look at it this way, you know, that, you know, kids are going to do things wrong, you know, and, you know, smoking is one of the things that kids will do wrong. I also talked with the principal about some of the other things. And in the past 12 years, they've only had 3 pregnant girls in the high school in 12 years.
Mm.
You know, so that says a lot to me. You know, having a 16-year-old daughter, that's one of the things that I worry about. You know, because they push abstinence because they're a small school and they can't.
Yeah.
And nobody wants that reputation in a small town. Everyone knows, everyone talks.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's a lot of positive benefits to it, and I guess in a couple of months when we've been there for a while and the kids go back to school and adjust, I think it's a positive change for all of us.
Well, I grew up in a small town area, and it was real shock to me when I had to go to a school in the nearby city, and because I had gone to small school nearby where I grew up, and it was very nice. That was Bartlett, Illinois, but then I had to go to the big city, to Elgin and big high school.
Yeah, and yeah. I think it's just as much a culture shock for country kids to go to a city school. But, I found they have some better activities in some of these country schools, better extracurricular activities and things like that. I mean, different things. Kids aren't out on the street, skipping school every day because somebody's parents going to see them and tell on them.
Yeah. Well, okay, that said, let's talk for a minute about warranties. I was doing a show the other day, and I said to people, look around your house at all the things that plug into the wall, and see if you can find something that plugs into the wall that is not made in China. And then when you do find all the stuff, you look at all the stuff that plugs into the wall, see if you've got something that plugs into the wall that was made in China that is more than 10 years old. And the answer is, you'll never find it.
Nope.
You'll never find it. We go to the store and we buy fans. They're all made in China now. There's nothing made in the USA. When they were made in the USA, they'd last a while. But now they'll last one season. And, of course, that 90-day warranty will expire, and then the fan will seize up, and you've got junk that goes to the dump. And this is terrible, terrible, terrible for the country, for the dumps, and for Mother Earth.
I agree. That's one thing about warranties is I figure it's 6 months after Christmas, so everybody's things are starting to break. And a lot of times, people don't have receipts for the things that they got for Christmas gifts. I was dealing with this about 2 weeks ago, and that's why one of my columns that I just wrote was about warranties and warranties without receipts. I called up about my coffee pot breaking. It was a $70 Mill & Brew coffee pot. So it wasn't cheap. I mean, if it was $10, I probably would have thrown it out and got another one. So I happened to find the book, and it's the coffee pot said it had a one-year warranty. Well, I was thrilled. So I called up the customer service and told them the top of my coffee pot broke. Well, the guy says, okay, it's a $5 part. Give me your credit card, and I'll send it to you. And I said, wait a minute here. I said, I got a one-year warranty. I got this coffee pot for Christmas. He says, well, then you'll have to submit a receipt telling us when you bought the coffee pot before I could do any warranty work. And this is how the warranty work will work. Is you'll have to pack the coffee pot in its original box with all its packing material, and you'll have to pay to send it back to us. We'll evaluate it, and we'll warranty it. We'll fix it, and we'll send it back, but it'll take 3 to 4 weeks. I said, 3 to 4 weeks without my coffee pot? I said, wait a minute, isn't there another way to do this? And he said, well, if you want it under warranty. I said, well, first of all, I have to pay to ship it back to you. He says, yeah. I said, then I have to have the original box. And he said, yeah. And I said, well, who keeps all their original boxes to everything they buy?
Nobody.
Exactly. So they try to make it so that, we can't do the warranty. So he says, well, I said, I got this coffee pot for Christmas. And he says, well, I need the receipt. And I said, well, I think it was bought on Amazon.com. I said, but, I don't have the receipt for it. And he says, well, then you can just buy the part, And I said, wait a minute. Isn't there a serial number or something on this that should tell you when it was manufactured? And you should be able to tell whether it's still in warranty or not. And he says, yes. I said, okay, can we do that?
Hang on. Yes, but is the phrase. Yes, but. We'll find the butt part out right after this. Chuck Carter for the people.
Now we flash back to the year 1941. Germany opens a 2,000-mile Russian front. By September, Leningrad was surrounded. It withstood siege for almost 900 days. Greece falls to Germany. In May, 1,500 German paratroopers took Crete in the first successful airborne invasion in the entire history of the military. Scientists begin work in secret on the Manhattan Project to develop an atomic bomb. From Hollywood, John Huston directs his first great film, The Maltese Falcon. And from Tin Pan Alley, the bell-bottom trouser look gets a bit of a boost.
You'll never be blue in a blue uniform. You're welcome as the flowers are laid. In every canteen, the minute they spot them, they came to enough for Mr. Bell-Bottom. It's easy to see. Every son of the sea is welcome wherever he goes. You'll never be blue in a blue uniform. And baby, I'm the guy who knows.
A few blocks away from Tin Pan Alley and Broadway, Noel Coward's Blithe Spirit was recognized by audiences as elegant high comedy. The Lend-Lease Act authorizes the United States to aid its allies. And on the radio...
Don't let my spurs get rusty while I'm gone. Don't let my spurs get rusty while I'm gone. I'll be wearing them spurs once more, just as soon as I win this war. Don't let my spurs get rusty while I'm gone. Don't let my boots get dusty while I'm gone. Don't let my boots get dusty while I'm gone.
Flashbacks from the year 1941.
With Gene Meyer, livingmoreandless.com. Gene, finish the story about the coffee pot and the warranty that wasn't.
Well, so I turned my coffee pot over and I found my warranty number, and the operator silently said, okay, it's under warranty. And I said, okay, so what do we need to do to get me the part to my coffee pot? He says, well, if I send you the part to your coffee pot, your coffee pot will no longer be under warranty if you replace the part yourself. I said, will I get the part for free? And he said, yes. I said, then send it to me. I said, because by the time I get it back, there's not going to be much left of my warranty anyway. I said, you know, this is an $80 coffee pot, you know. I said, I'll just have to remember that next time I go to buy an item from your company. And he says, all right, well, you'll receive your part in 6 to 8 weeks. So as it all, you know, boils down to it, I will get my coffee pot part that I need to fix it, and it shouldn't be too hard to put it on. But I think people need to know that there's an alternate way, you know, if you don't have a receipt, on how to get your warranty work done. A lot of people don't know about the code numbers on the bottom, which signify the manufacturer's date, and a lot of people's warranties don't get fulfilled because the customer service person won't tell them this information.
Yeah. Well, the thing that's so sad about it is that what most people don't know is that when they do send the parts out, they send them out by bulk mail. Did you know that?
Nope.
Yeah. There is a system of mail called standard mail. Most people don't even know it exists. And what they do is they aggregate either more than 50 packages, okay, it's 50 packages at a time, or 50 pounds. And then they can send the packages out at what they call the bulk rate, which is about, oh, a third of the cost of parcel post or less. Very, very cheap. And that's why the 6 to 8 weeks, because it'll take 3 to 4 weeks for that in the mail to get to you.
Well, you know, the way I feel like I won because I didn't let them tell me no. It didn't cost me anything to send my part back to them, my broken piece back to them. And for now, my coffee pot is working. I'm not without it for, you know, 3 to 4 weeks for them to return it. And I've learned a very important lesson. If I'm going to buy something like a coffee pot that has a warranty, if nothing else, I'm going to at least buy something from a company who will honor their own warranties.
Now, what was the name of this coffee pot? Was it Black & Decker?
No.
Who was it?
Melita.
Oh, those folks, okay.
Yep. Also, people don't understand that a lot of companies outsource their
warranty work.
Yeah. And so this particular company, when I called them, they said, well, we do this, 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 and this, and press this if you have a George Foreman grill or if you have this or
right.
You have that. And everything I pushed was my other. And so finally I got there, and you know, the customer service man didn't seem too excited about my call.
Yeah. Well, where did you end up? Was it up there in the Midwest, in the upper Midwest, somewhere near Kansas?
I don't think so.
Yeah. There's a big company up there. I forget where they are, but there's a big company up there that does that for a whole bunch of different people.
You know, the only thing I was pleased with, Chuck,
yeah,
was the fact that the person actually spoke English.
Gee, that's kind of rare.
Yeah, hey, that's what I thought.
Thanks for being with us. LivingMoreOnLess.com. Thank you so much. Take care. All right, ladies and gentlemen, a prayer for the troops, you and your loved ones, and our country. If you'd like to help us in our mission, you can send a tax-deductible donation to For the People. That's For the People, P.O. Box 150, P.O. Box 150, Tampa, Florida, 33601. P.O. Box 150, Tampa, Florida, 33601. Thanks, everybody. Up and down the radio trail, God bless you, too. Amen.